In the 10th episode of Cocaine and Rhinestones, you heard some of this song because Buck Owens played lead guitar on it.
In Big Mamoon, Louisiana, they play a broken down piano. The people always gather around to sing. Now making eyes and holding hands, she's my woman, I'm her man, when we do the Louisiana swing.
I've seen it called the first song with the Bakersfield Sound on it. What is the Bakersfield Sound? Where did it come from? One guy playing on this song is named Bill Woods. He's known as the father of the Bakersfield Sound. But that's less because of his great piano playing, and more because of the patriarchal role he served in Bakersfield's music community. In Bakersfield's heyday, he led the most popular house band in town, the Orange Blossom Playboys. The musicians he hired were simply the best. Everyone knew it, and many of the players who did come to define the Bakersfield sound came through that band. One of them was Buck Owens. We could argue all day long about what the Bakersfield sound even is, so I would be a jackass to stand here and tell you any one person invented it. When I talk about the Bakersfield sound, I'm talking about a style of music performance and a style of music production that Buck Owens made famous and where it went from there. Twangy Telecaster guitar parts with a high-end tone that could slice right through an AM radio signal. A whirlwind of whining pedal steel guitars and crying fiddles coming in and out of the mix. Oh, and you could take that tube compressor and throw it in the trash because we will not be squashing the dynamics in our tracks. Thank you very much. No, not even on the drums. If he hits the kick harder at the end of the verse, that's because it's supposed to be louder there. In fact, since we have stereo now, pan that all the way into one channel and let the reverb live on the other side. Yeah, sounds good. In other words, this is electric honky-tonk music. Born out of having to play a blend of several musical genres through awful sound systems for rowdy crowds in loud dive bars. And you don't have to do anything special in the studio to make it sound good, except get out of the way. Because the people in that room playing those instruments do this for hours every single day. If we go back and listen to the rest of that first Bakersfield Sound song, we hear that it's just Western swing. We begin to wonder if people who say it's the first song with this sound on it, maybe what they mean is the people responsible for the song. It's a Sheb Woolley song done by Bud Hobbs and his trail herders. Those trail herders are Bill Woods and the Orange Blossom Playboys. At the time, that means Bill Woods on piano, Big Roy Lee on bass, Oscar Whittington and Jelly Sanders on fiddle, Tommy Collins on guitar, Johnny Cuviella on drums, and Dusty Rhodes on steel. It's plain as day, these guys can shred some Western swing. But then, for less than 15 seconds, Buck Owens' guitar comes in.
Oh, Buck Owens, let's hear from you.
Oh, that's probably what people mean when they say this is the first song with the Bakersfield sound on it, because there it is, right there. Again, I'm not saying Buck Owens gave birth to the Bakersfield sound, but he was damn sure in the delivery room and he made that baby a star. Even if you do think Buck Owens is the walking, talking definition of the Bakersfield sound, you've got to add a lot more than Western swing to him to get it. Even if you think Buck Owens is the devil and the other guys playing on that session or any of 100 other individuals deserve all the credit, well, they were all listening to and playing the same things. Buck Owens is more famous than any of them, and we have much more information on him and his influences, so it doesn't really matter who we think deserves the credit. If we're trying to dig up some roots of the Bakersfield sound, the easiest way is by looking at Buck Owens' influences. One time, Merle Haggard said Wynn Stewart's sound is what influenced him and Buck Owens both. Merle calls Wynn Stewart's sound the basis of the West Coast sound. Now, this is gonna piss some people off, but under no circumstances, by any definition, was Merle Haggard involved in creating the Bakersfield sound. His early records sound like they were made in Nashville by the same people producing Marty Robbins. Honestly, at the beginning of his career, he was just a few steps removed from being a Marty Robbins impersonator.
I'm singing my heart out to you.
You sit there in the crowd with your new love, and each song I sing, I dedicate to you.
There is nothing wrong with that. Marty Robbins is phenomenal. Merle Haggard is phenomenal. But it is a world apart. All of that being said, here's Wynn Stewart's first single. I've waited a lifetime.
In my dreams, I hold you in my heart. But in real life, we are miles apart. Those days we spent in the heaven we knew, those days were meant just for me and you.
That came out in 1954, the same year Buck Owens played lead guitar on that Bud Hobbs song. And you absolutely can hear Wynn Stewart's influence in the music Buck Owens would go on to make, as well as the entirety of anything you want to call the Bakersfield sound. So it appears we're on the right track here, looking at Buck Owens' influences. Among many others, here's who else we'll find behind this door. Jimmy Bryant, Roy Nichols, Skeets McDonald, Jack Guthrie, and the Maddox Brothers with Rose.
It's all going to Georgia play now.
From 1937 to 1956, the Maddox Brothers with Rose made the rowdiest hillbilly music ever recorded.
There's a real hot spot on the Waterloo Road. Got a hillbilly band called Maddox and Rose. Georgia's Playhouse, so the story goes, where they play a boogie-woogie that'll wiggle your toes. Pull off the shoes and what a sight when they do the boogie-woogie on a Friday night.
Oh, let's go now.
Maybe rock and roll, rockabilly, and punk music would have happened if the Maddox Brothers with Rose never existed.
Stop it, I can't stand it, it's driving me insane.
Maybe. But they influenced everyone making honky-tonk music on the West Coast, played and sang like they were jacked up on trucker speed, took flashy Western wear to a new extreme, and introduced Roy Nichols' lightning-hot guitar playing to the world. From 1948 to 1950, Roy Nichols was in the studio and on the road with the Maddox Brothers. They hired him when he was only 15 years old because he was already that good. Little Buck and Bonnie Owens saw Roy play with the Maddox Brothers and Rose at a stop in Mesa, Arizona. Roy spent 1953 in Lefty Frizzell's band, which is when a teenage Merle Haggard saw him play for the first time. From 1950 to 1956, Jimmy Bryant was Ken Nelson's favorite guitar player for session work at Capitol Records. His playing style is a big influence on Buck Owens. Jimmy and his partner, pedal steel guitarist Speedy West, were popular enough to release recordings under their own names. While also playing on hundreds of sides for other artists like Tennessee Ernie Ford and Sheb Woolley.
Chuggity chug chug chug. I
never liked a hot rod or a motorbike, but I'm a syncopated sucker for a country ride. You would never find me on an aeroplane. You couldn't even get me in a streamlined train.
Great stuff, but apparently Jimmy Bryant wasn't the easiest guy to deal with. When Buck Owens came around with his professional work ethic, Ken Nelson started calling Jimmy less and Buck more. We already heard the rest of that story. It includes Buck Owens becoming an iconically successful artist after Capitol Records finally let him control what happened in his own recording session. One of the players on that session was a man Buck refers to in his autobiography as the great Ralph Mooney. What's important to understand here is Buck isn't calling him that because it's 40 years later and he's writing his memoirs after everyone went on to make history. Mooney played on every one of Buck's first 7 top 10 singles, but that's not why he's calling him great either. Buck Owens thought of him as the great Ralph Mooney right there in that very first session. Because there, in 1959, Moon was already a part of country music history. See, several years before this, a little song that Ralph wrote came out and instantly altered the course of country music in the second half of the 1950s. And Ralph Mooney's work in Wynn Stewart's band is just as much as anyone or anything else a main ingredient of the Bakersfield sound. Somehow, despite all of that, Moon is most well known for being Waylon Jennings' pedal steel player in the 70s and 80s. Well, today, I'm here to tell you why we'd still be talking about Ralph Mooney if Waylon Jennings had never been born. You're listening to Cocaine and Rhinestones, the podcast about 20th century country music and the lives of those who gave it to us. My name is Tyler Mahan Coe. I've heard these stories my whole life. As far as I can tell, here's the truth about this one. Ralph Mooney was born in 1928 in Oklahoma. At the age of 12, he moved to California to live with his older sister and her husband. It looks like this brother-in-law is who taught Ralph how to play guitar, fiddle, and mandolin. Then Ralph heard a steel guitar.
Gig it off, Leon. Gig it off.
There's no telling how many kids tried to imitate the sound of Leon McAuliffe playing steel guitar rag. Hopefully, most of them didn't use a knife, which is what Ralph did. After learning about pedal steel guitars, Ralph built his own out of wooden planks, steel rods, and coat hangers. If you've never seen a pedal steel in action, it's a little difficult to explain. A steel guitar is pretty much a guitar built into a tabletop with the strings raised up real high and open-tuned, so you can slide a solid metal bar over them for a unique sound. That becomes a pedal steel guitar when you install a bunch of pedals and levers for your feet and knees to bend certain strings up or down while you play. To anyone who doesn't play one, it looks like witchcraft, but to fans of country music,
if it's true you turn me down, a honky tonk and I'll be found. If it happens, I got a new field to plow.
It sounds like heaven. This is one of the instruments that critics of the Nashville sound say was missing from the pop country coming out of Music City starting in the late 50s. Of course, what they were really used to hearing were the much older and twangier sounds of non-pedal steel and dobro. Pedal steel guitar wasn't recorded in country music until 1949, when Speedy West played one on Eddie Kirk's Candy Kisses.
Now my castles all have tumbled, and I'm alone, sad and blue.
Was big on the Los Angeles scene, so Ralph Mooney may very well have heard Speedy playing on this song as soon as it came out. Most people will tell you it wasn't until 1954, when Bud Isaacs played one on Webb Pierce's Slowly, that pedal steel replaced non-pedal steel as the standard in country music.
Slowly I'm falling with you, slowly you're winning a heart that can be true. Now I can't hide my feelings, no matter what I do, for slowly I'm falling more in love with you.
But way before that, Speedy's pedal steel guitar, along with Jimmy Bryant's electric guitar, were signature elements of country, rockabilly, and pop songs coming out of LA. From 1949 on, Ralph Mooney and everyone else on the West Coast were hearing pedal steel on records by artists like Johnny Horton, Sheb Woolley, and Tennessee Ernie Ford.
She only wants to see me when I get my pay, then she calls somebody else to go out and play, but I ain't gonna let it happen no more.
Working from these great influences and his experience on other instruments, Ralph found his way around that homemade pedal steel. And it may not have been lovely to look at, but Leo Fender would eventually ask to borrow it to study the design, giving him in return a Fender pedal steel guitar to play on tour. Ralph's first band gets hired by a neighbor to play a gig, which leads to more gigs, and pretty soon Mooney is in the house band of the popular Squeakin' Deacon radio show in LA. This is where Ralph Mooney meets Wynn Stewart. The year is 1950. Mooney's about 22 years old, and Wynn is around 16. Here's how Ralph remembers it. Wynn and his dad would come in every Sunday to this talent contest that Squeakin' Deacon held at the Compton Ballroom. He was called Winford then. He won that talent contest every time. People hated to see him come in. You'd win a wristwatch, and he would come in and show off this armful of wristwatches. Winford is winning so many talent shows that he starts going by Wynn, W-I-N, Stewart, around the time Mooney begins playing in his band. For the rest of his career, no matter who he's playing with, Ralph Mooney thinks of himself as Wynn Stewart's steel player. In 1954, Wynn gets his first record deal with a little indie label. What's interesting is Moon remembers playing lead guitar. Listen to the instrumental break and you can hear the beginning of what we think of as Mooney's signature sound in the lead guitar.
I'm just a little bit lonesome, and just a little bit blue. I've waited a lifetime, my dear, for you.
Thank you.
having played guitar longer, it makes sense that he'd develop his style there and move it over to the pedal steel. The same year, he plays steel on a Terry Fell session, a pretty typical steel part. So he isn't really Moon yet, but he's a good steel player, and the session work keeps coming in. What I want to do right now is run through some of his pedal steel parts over the next 5 years, so you can hear the progression of his style and how quickly he found a unique voice. Again, the first Wynn Stewart song and the Terry Fell song are 1954. So 1955, Skeets McDonald, Strollin'.
So each night I go strollin' and dream that I'm holding you in my arms again.
...1956, rockabilly singer Glenn Glenn, a.k.a. Glenn Trout, 100 years from now.
If I lose you tomorrow, or if I lose you now, what difference will it make 100 years from now?
...1957, Skeets McDonald again on a song Mooney helped write, Keep Her Off Your Mind.
You better keep her off your mind. I don't mean maybe. You better keep her off your mind, 'cause she's my baby.
I'd call that one a moonshot, but we're still going. 1958, Wanda Jackson, Honey Bop.
Well, the waltz is for a square, and the rumba is too old, baby. We're just rockin', let it satisfy us. Oh, oh, bop. Well, honey bop. Oh, 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 bop. Honey bop. Oh, 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 bop. Honey bop. Don't stop. Honey bop.
...1959, brilliant interplay with Wynn Stewart's vocal on the chorus of Wishful Thinking.
I'll just live my life in dreams and long for your love. It's you I'm wishing for, and it's you I'm thinking of. My heart echoes the love words you've spoken. How I wish I could hear them from you. Won't you answer a heart that is broken and make my wishful thinking come true?
And by 1960, Ralph Mooney is such a respected pedal steel guitarist that he's going in the studio for himself to cut instrumental covers of popular songs like Eddie Miller's Release Me. Now, I could do this for an hour, and it would be awesome, but records never tell the whole story. Today, with social media and everyone walking around with a camera and the internet in our pockets, we can forget that whatever went on in any given local music scene 50 years ago, almost all of it went undocumented. What we have are the records, hopefully some studio session logbooks, maybe newspaper clippings here and there for the bigger players, and whatever memories survive long enough to make it into an interview when the book gets written, if a book gets written. There are some big cracks in the house that builds, and a lot falls through. If you get lucky, the musicians like to party hard enough and act like big enough assholes to each other that the stories are funny enough to remember. Let's just say I got pretty lucky with this episode. We'll start from 1954. For a few years now, Moon and Wynn Stewart have been playing together around Los Angeles. Buck Owens has started driving down from Bakersfield for session work at Capitol Records, and in about another year, he'll be leading his own house band at the Blackboard in Bakersfield. Musicians in LA and Bakersfield are constantly driving back and forth to make whatever money they can playing music. And actually, for the rest of this story, it's gonna be impossible to keep track of where everyone is living at any given time. Because add Las Vegas, Nevada, and everyone we're gonna be talking about is living in one of these places and driving to the other two for paying gigs. For some of these guys, Vegas is probably the worst place in the world to be, but several of them like Sin City so much they move there. 1956 is when I hear Ralph Mooney become Ralph Mooney on recordings. That may have happened earlier, but it does not matter. By 1957, we'd be talking about Moon even if he'd never touched a pedal steel guitar in his life. Because he wrote Crazy Arms, the song that single-handedly changed the sound of honky-tonk music in 1956. Ray Price had the hit with it, and it may be difficult now to hear how revolutionary it was then, because everything that's happened since was influenced by Crazy Arms. The story goes they were having a hard time getting a good bass sound in the studio. Ray Price suggested the bass play a 4-4 line instead of what would have then been a standard 2-4 bass line. Here, pay attention to the bass on Buck Owens' first single, 1955's Down on the Corner of Love.
When the sun goes down and the moon comes round, I'll be down on the corner of love.
That's a 2-4 bass line. That's what a honky-tonk bass player did until Ray Price's Crazy Arms came out in 1956, sounding like this.
This ain't no crazy dream, I know that it's real. You're someone else's love now, you're not mine. My yearning heart keeps saying you're not mine. My troubled mind knows soon to another you'll be with. And that's why I'm lonely all the time.
Packing more notes into the bass part got rid of their sound issue. More importantly, it represents a major step toward Ray Price's signature country shuffle sound. It's his first number one record, and the song spends 5 months at number one. Nearly half a year at number one. That's more time at number one than all but 4 other songs in the 1900s. And when the public hears something new that they love that much, it's not new anymore. It's the way you do it from now on. 1958, Buck Owens' first session at Capitol, where he's in control, gives him his first hit, Second Fiddle. Listen to that Ray Price shuffle, that bass, and listen to Ralph Mooney.
Like an early morning paper, the news you get just part. Why must I always have to play second fiddle in your heart?
That's because of Crazy Arms. That's why Buck Owens thinks he's the great Ralph Mooney the first time he's got him in the studio. The song was written by Mooney after his wife left him. Remember when I said Las Vegas was a bad place for some of these guys to be? Ralph Mooney is one of those guys. Whatever else he's doing out there, he's for sure drinking a lot. According to Waylon Jennings in his autobiography, Ralph is getting, quote, crawling, falling down drunk, end quote, let's say, often. Mrs. Moon catches him with another woman and leaves, inspiring him to write the song with his friend Chuck Seals. I don't know exactly when all this happened, but Waylon thinks it's in Las Vegas in 1950. That sounds a little early to me, but wherever and whenever the song was written, Hank Cochran tells my favorite version of how it got to Ray Price, so I'm going with him. This guy in California had a wife who didn't sing, but he thought she did, and she thought she did, and they would make records and put them out. Ralph Mooney was playing steel guitar. He was the hot thing out there. And he asked the guy, why in the hell don't you start a publishing company and put the songs that you record in that company and see what little airplay you get? If you get any at all, at least you'll get some money from it. I'll break in here to point out that Mooney was occasionally getting songs he wrote recorded in the sessions he'd do for Capitol. So if you go back and look at a song he wrote like 10 years ago, recorded by Bobby Austin.
10 years, I've tried everything to make you love me, but it's a prison, not a castle that I built. 10 years, you kept every vow that you made to me, except the one you couldn't fulfill.
Produced by Ken Nelson, you'll see the publishing on that is with Central Songs. If you listen to the Buck Owens episodes of this podcast, Hank Cochran's story means Buck wasn't the only one paying attention to where some of Ken Nelson's supplemental income was coming from. Okay, so the guy with the wife who can't sing gets up and goes to the bathroom and sees a bottle of Pamper shampoo. He comes back and asks what everybody thinks of Pamper Music as the name of a publishing company. Everyone likes it, and the guy asks if anybody has any songs. Back to Hank Cochran. Ralph Mooney says, me and Chuck Seals has got a song called, it's a little weird, called Crazy Arms. The guy says, well, is it good? You think we can do it? Well, let's try it. So they cut Crazy Arms on his wife, who couldn't sing, and shipped it out. And this DJ in Florida played it a little, and he got all these calls, as bad as it was, because the song was so good. Ray Price comes through the station, and the DJ says, hey Ray, I've got a record that's the worst you ever heard by a woman who sings so bad, but the song gets calls you can't believe every time I play it. To make a long story short, Ray listens to the song, loves it, etc., etc. Hank Cochran's story is funny enough, but the real reason it's my favorite version is that the guy with the wife who can't sing is Claude Cavendish, and Hank calls him Claude Cavendish every time he mentions him. This is the same Claude Cavendish who owns Pep Records and put out Buck Owens' first singles, which would make Claude's wife Marilyn Kay, and this, the recording of Crazy Arms that DJ would have played for Ray Price.
Crazy arms that reach out to hold somebody new, and my yearning heart told me that you were mine. But my troubled mind has found to another you will win. And that's why I'm lonely all the time.
Ray takes the song, changes some of the lyrics, and has such a big hit with it that Claude travels from California to Nashville to ask if Ray wants to make Pamper Music an actual publishing company, instead of just some words printed on a label. Ray brings in Hal Smith, and they get to work, hiring Hank Cochran as their first staff writer, a young Willie Nelson as their second, and Harlan Howard as their third. Crazy, Hello Walls, Heartaches by the Number, and Make the World Go Away are only a few of the all-time legendary hits that come out of Pamper Music. It all started with Crazy Arms. Crazy Arms goes on to be recorded by Chuck Berry.
Blue ain't the word for the way that I feel, 'cause a storm is brewing in this heart of mine.
Mickey Gilley.
This ain't no crazy dream, I know that's real. You're someone else's love now, you're not mine.
Patti Loveless.
Crazy arms that reach to hold somebody new, but my yearning heart keeps saying you're not mine.
And far too many more artists to list them all here. When Jerry Lee Lewis records an audition for Cowboy Jack Clement at Sun Records in 1956, he plays Crazy Arms. In 1979, Ray Price records the song again with Willie Nelson and has a hit with it again. By the way, someone out there found an acetate demo of Crazy Arms sung by Wynn Stewart, dated 1954. Though it was never released, that would give him the first known recording of the song. Two more important things that happen in 1956 are Wynn Stewart gets signed to Capitol Records.
And the waltz of the angels he wrote just for you.
And introduces Harlan Howard to Buck Owens. Those two go on to write some of Buck's biggest hits together, including Tiger by the Tail. In 1961, Buck Owens will record an entire full length of Harlan Howard's material. It's great. Ralph Mooney plays on it.
I know that you've been fooling around on me right from the start. So I'll take back my ring and I'll take back my heart. And when you're tired of fooling around with two or three, come on home and fool around with me.
When Buck hires his first touring pedal steel player, Jay McDonald, it's specifically because he thinks Jay does an okay job of mimicking Ralph Mooney. This whole time, Moon is Wynn Stewart's guy, but he's taking session work wherever he can get it, and playing in other bands too. Because the thing about Wynn Stewart is that he's amazing at making records. But when it comes to everything else, Wynn is a total flake. He's so bad at staying in communication with everyone on his team that he rarely even ends up touring after the release of a new single. He'll disappear for months at a time, leaving everyone to get by on their own. 1959 finds Ralph Mooney in Gene Davis's band at the Palomino Club. In 1960, he's back with Wynn at George's Roundup, and Roy Nichols is now in the band too. These are Los Angeles venues. By 1961, Las Vegas is a hot town for country music. To this day, Vegas is a place where you can see once-in-a-lifetime performances from the best musicians in the world. And I'm not talking about the showrooms on the Strip. The headliners in those showrooms are some of the biggest names in music, meaning they have very, very good bands. Often, the incredible musicians in these bands will get done playing the same songs they play every night for work, head out to a low-key dive to meet up with other incredible players from other A-list bands, and play until sunrise just for fun. The last thing they want to play is what they just got done with at their job. Left to their own devices, these musicians are gonna cut way loose and dig into some heavy stuff they'd never get away with on the strip. And they're playing for the late night party crowds who wanna dance. So in the early 60s, that's gonna mean boogie blues of guys like Howlin' Wolf and John Lee Hooker. Or the style of honky-tonk music we've been calling the Bakersfield Sound, imported straight from California. Years later, when an interviewer opens by telling Mooney that he's the one who gave Buck Owens and Merle Haggard the West Coast sound, the first two words out of Mooney's mouth are Wynn Stewart. 1961, Wynn Stewart is part owner of the Nashville, Nevada Club in Las Vegas. His band is the House Band. Again, it's difficult to keep track of who's living where because everyone's always driving back and forth between Vegas and LA and Bakersfield. One of these trips between Los Angeles and Las Vegas, Mooney and Wynn are having some road beers and they pull over to take a piss next to an abandoned building. I don't know why they have a can of spray paint, but they do. And they paint, "Coming soon, Wynn and Moon," on the side of that building. I wonder if they thought they were joking. 1961 is the year Ralph Mooney lays down one of the most recognizable pedal steel intros ever on Wynn Stewart's Big Big Love.
Can't you tell my love's growing? Can't you feel it ain't showing? Oh, you must be a-knowing. Got a big, big love. It's not the kind to be concealing, just the kind to be revealing. It's not a little bitty feeling. I've got a big, big love. I think it's time we done some walking.
The song is rightfully recognized as a classic now, and it does okay at the time. But the real mark Wynn and Moon are about to make on country music together is just by playing the Nashville, Nevada Club. The club stays open 24 hours a day. When you add in Wynn's wonderful band, this is the late night spot. It's in this room, not anywhere in California, where many hugely influential musicians and artists are first exposed to the Bakersfield sound. The Bakersfield music scene is great, and nationally touring acts do come through. But the kind of national acts who tour in a car. Vegas is where all the people with number one records are running around. Here's what Moon said in one interview. There was always a big crowd at the club. Everybody from the country bands would stop by after their set was over. Patsy Cline came by just before she died and told me she was gonna record Crazy Arms. What Patsy didn't tell Moon is that she'd already recorded a demo of the song years earlier. However, she did do Crazy Arms again in her final recording session.
Blue's not the word for the way that I feel, and the storm brewing in this heart of mine. This is no treasure dream. I know that it's real. You're someone else's love now. You're not mine.
The thing about this little Patsy Cline story, there was probably a star that big in the Nashville, Nevada club multiple times a week. Here's what Merle Haggard said about the room. The sound moved right through your danged body. It was the best sound system I'd ever heard. It's somewhere in 1962 that Merle starts showing up at the club. Roy Nichols is on stage playing one night when he sees Merle in the crowd, recognizes him from somewhere, and the way Merle tells it, "He just went to waving, almost throwing his guitar at me. He said, 'Take this son of a bitch and play it for a minute and let me get to the bathroom.'" It was like a guy being thrown into the New York Yankees and they say, "Hey, pitch one." Ralph Mooney said, "Can you sing?" I said, "Yes, I believe I can sing something." They do Cigarette and Coffee Blues, some other song, and then Marty Robbins' Devil Woman, which is not an easy song to sing the right way. I'm so pleased to tell you there's a fantastic clip on YouTube of Merle Haggard singing this song, doing his best Marty Robbins impersonation, for a television audience, with Marty Robbins sitting at a piano maybe 7 feet away from him.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Merle sings it so well, the audience can't help but laugh.
I told Mary about us. I told her about a great thing. Mary cried, forgave me.
When it gets to the chorus, though, you can see Marty's face and entire body language go from, ha-ha, this is a good impersonation of me, to, hey, wait a minute, this guy's gonna put me out of a job.
But I don't wanna be, and I don't wanna see Mary cry anymore. Oh, devil woman, laugh at me. Devil woman, laugh at me. Leave me alone, I wanna go home.
The crowd loses it. Merle tells the rest of the story of being on stage that night at the Nashville, Nevada club. I was doing that song, and in the middle of the dance floor, I looked, and there was Wynn Stewart, standing and looking at me with his arms crossed and his head kinda cocked over to one side. Wynn offers Merle double of whatever he's making wherever else in Bakersfield to come join Wynn's band, be his bass player and backup singer. Everyone jokes that Merle isn't a very good bass player. Or I don't know, maybe they aren't joking, but Merle is such a good singer that nobody really cares. He's in Wynn's band for about a year until he gets a record deal with Capitol in 1963. His first single for Capitol is a brand new Wynn Stewart composition that Merle asked if he could have. Wynn's entire band plays on the session, including Wynn on guitar.
Sing me song. Sadness and singing as blue as I feel. If a tear should appear, it's because she's not here. Sing a sad song and sing.
When it hits the top 20, Merle leaves to go become a star. Wynn Stewart never should have lived in Las Vegas. He's got a gambling problem, a drinking problem. At one point in the mid-60s, he's in such bad shape that his musicians vote him out of his own band. Mooney goes on tour with Merle Haggard for a bit, but that doesn't last very long. They're up in Minneapolis when a real bad snowstorm hits. It's so cold, the bus won't start, and there's so much snow they wouldn't be able to drive anywhere even if it did. Mooney gets cabin fever at the hotel, decides he can get that damn bus started and drive it on home. Well, he does manage to get it started, but the driver runs out and stops him from trying to go anywhere. That's about the end of Ralph Mooney's days as a stranger, but you can hear his pedal steel on Merle Haggard's first four albums, with two top five singles in there. I Threw Away the Rose and Swingin' Doors.
This old smoke-filled bar is something I'm not used to. But I gave up my home to see you satisfied. And I just called to let you know where I'll be living. It's not much, but I feel welcome here inside. I've got swinging doors, a jukebox, and a bar stool.
Moon spends the second half of the 60s with more session work, making an album of instrumentals with James Burton right before James becomes Elvis Presley's guitar player. And, as always, off and on with Wynn Stewart. In 1965, Wynn re-signs to Capitol Records, and in 1967, he has his only number one single, It's Such a Pretty World Today.
It's such a pretty world today. Look at the sunshine.
Look at the sunshine.
Today and every day since I met you.
As you could hear, Mooney is somehow not on that session. But all his stories of being on the road with Wynn around 1969 give us a great idea of the kind of trouble these guys have always been getting into. Apparently, Wynn loves nothing more than to get real drunk and go fishing. They carry fishing poles and tackle everywhere along with all the band's music equipment. He'll make himself late to a concert if he sees a pond that looks like it might have some fish in it. Well, this one time, they're in New Jersey with a week off. Moon and another guy in the band named Hap Arnold are staying in this cabin on a lake while Wynn flies home for a few days. When Wynn flies back, he's bought a bunch of new fishing gear for that lake. He shows up with a fancy rod and tackle box, plus bait and a huge bottle of gin. He wants to get fishing right away. First thing he does is haul all that gear out onto the old rundown dock, which collapses, and Wynn loses everything, except for that bottle of gin. He doesn't spill a drop of the gin. Moon and Hap still have their gear, so after everyone gets done laughing at Wynn, they stay and fish until it's so late they don't even have time to cook the fish they caught before they have to leave. For some reason, they leave the fish in the cabin, maybe thinking the next guest will find them and eat them. Only nobody else stays in that cabin for 2 weeks. By the time anyone does go in there, the smell is so horrific, they're told to never come back. Another time in Iowa, Wynn's got a radio interview and Moon and Hap tag along since they've all three been out drinking the whole night. They're listening to the station on the way there and Wynn keeps saying he thinks the signal sounds pretty weak for a 50,000 watt tower. They get to the studio, they're standing around waiting for the interview when Wynn notices some big knobs that are not turned all the way up. Figuring that must be why the signal sounded weak in the car, he reaches over, cranks those knobs, and blows the radio tubes, killing the station's entire broadcast signal. Ralph and Hap sneak out the back door. Thanks to Wynn's number one hit in 1967, their Vegas stops now have them in the big fancy showrooms instead of the old honky-tonks. One of the things that makes Ralph Mooney such a great pedal steel guitarist is that he truly loves his instrument. He never stops playing. There are so many people with a story about walking around somewhere, hearing Ralph Mooney practicing, and hanging around to listen for hours. You get the impression he'd just as soon be homeless as long as he had a pedal steel guitar. So even on these showroom gigs, where you usually do at least two sets a night, a lot of times Moon and Roy Nichols will hang around on stage playing together between sets, just for themselves, just to play. The drummer Richie Albright is changing into or out of his stage clothes one night in a dressing room at the Golden Nugget, when he hears Moon working on some licks. Richie becomes so invested in what he's hearing that he falls over on the floor while halfway inside a pair of pants. This is the story of how Ralph Mooney comes to meet Richie Albright's boss, and the man Moon will spend the next 20 years with, Waylon Jennings. After writing a song that changed the way country shuffles are done, a song that led to Hank Cochran, Harlan Howard, and Willie Nelson all writing songs for the same publishing company. After helping to create the Bakersfield Sound and export it to the high-profile music scene of Las Vegas, Ralph Mooney now moves on to a starring role in yet another major upgrade to the sound of country music, outlaw country. From 1971 to 1987, with no exceptions that I know of, every steel guitar part on every Waylon Jennings album is played by Ralph Mooney. Nearly all of the dobro parts as well, sometimes both on the same song.
Let the world call me a fool, but if things are right with me and you, that's all that matters, and I'll do anything you ask me to.
According to many people who would know, Waylon Jennings is Ralph Mooney's biggest fan. Richie Albright tells us that Waylon always said there's only one steel guitar player, and his name is Ralph Mooney. We can bank on those words because in his autobiography, Waylon spends entire paragraphs talking about Moon and the general excellence of the other musicians in his band, the Wailers. In his words, quote, "The band could do just about anything. It didn't matter what the tune was. It just seemed like somebody would grab a hold of it and go. Get it started in one direction and then change direction, zigging and zagging. Mooney was at the heart of it. He was a cult legend in his own right, a steel guitar genius, and he was in his heyday. When I played in England and introduced the band, Mooney got a bigger hand than me." End quote. That goes for the records too, of course, but what Waylon is really talking about here is playing with the band, show to show, out on tour. There are bands that go out and play the same set of songs the same way in the same order every single night. Then there are bands that try to keep it interesting for themselves by throwing some curveballs to each other in the middle of the set, calling out songs they don't often do, putting the emphasis on the rhythm in a different place, taking the lead breaks away from each other. You can hear a band like this in action by listening to how live performances of the same song will change over the years. Take Lonesome, Ornery, and Mean. Here's that in 1975, in front of a small TV studio audience.
On a Greyhound bus, Lord, I'm traveling this morning.
Pretty laid back, Moon stays low key in the first verses, with a lick here and there.
Been traveling these highways, I've been doing things my way. It's been making me lonesome, ornery and mean.
Compare that with the same song in the 1978 show known as the Lost Outlaw Concert. They're in front of a huge crowd and cooking right out of the gate. The tempo's slightly faster and Moon's playing busy lead over the entire first verse.
On a Greyhound bus, Lord, I'm traveling this morning. I'm going to Shreveport and down to New Orleans. Been traveling these highways.
That's what Waylon's talking about when he goes on to say, quote, "He could be cantankerous, but he had a touch on his instrument that went beyond steel decorations. If you weren't in the pocket for him when he took his ride, you would be by the time he came out the other side. If it was early in the show and things hadn't quite found their groove yet, he had the unique ability to put it there, pumping pedals and stroking the bar across the strings." End quote. This is the way someone would normally be talking about the drummer of a band. When musicians use terms like in the pocket or finding the groove, they're always talking about the rhythm section, the drummer and bass player. I've never, ever heard someone talk about a pedal steel guitarist controlling the groove this way. Highly unusual. Waylon finds these concerts so fascinating they record every show and listen back to it each night on the bus. Some of you noticed Waylon calling Ralph cantankerous. He goes on to say if Ralph was shy when he was sober, he could be a holy terror when he got near the bottle. Bill Conrad, Waylon's in-house publicist, has written a film treatment about his time on the job. Mooney is depicted as passing out on his instrument in the middle of a concert. Waylon speaks into the microphone, "The moon has set." I don't know that Bill is even saying that really happened or not, but Mooney puts in over 15 years of drinking on tour with Waylon. When country music fan and writer Chet Flippo goes on tour with Waylon around 1972, he sees Ralph Mooney as someone who looks more like a bank teller than one of country's great sidemen. Then Mooney tells Chet exactly how one goes about cleaning vomit from a pedal steel guitar, saying he's only ever had to do it himself one time and hopefully won't ever have to again. And Chet notices Moon sipping straight gin during intermissions. In my opinion, the best Ralph Mooney story of all can be found in Waylon's autobiography. He says Ralph was, to say the least, a character, then tells Chet Atkins' favorite story about Ralph Mooney, or rather about the fiddle player Johnny Gimble recognizing Moon on an airplane. Gimble's a big Ralph Mooney fan, so he goes up to him saying, "I'm Johnny Gimble the fiddler, and I want you to know that I really love your steel playing. I appreciate your work." Mooney, presumably drunk, replies, "Aw, fuck you." So Johnny goes back to his seat. It's about a year after that when Gimble sees Ralph Mooney again in a recording session. This time, everything seems to be going really well between them. So Johnny asks if Moon remembers the time he told Johnny, "fuck you" on the airplane, and what exactly did he mean by saying, "fuck you" on the airplane? Mooney says, "I meant, fuck you." Ralph Mooney didn't spend the rest of his life just riding buses and planes around the world, from stage to recording studio to hotel room, drinking gin and telling innocent fans, "fuck you." If you asked him, he'd tell you that he would have starved to death except for those royalty checks from Crazy Arms. I'm sure that's a joke, but I'm also sure those checks were nice, so it's not surprising that he kept writing songs. In 1983, Johnny Rodriguez had a top 5 hit with a Ralph Mooney song called Foolin', produced by Richie Albright.
And now that I realize that I can't have you, it's finally dawned on me just who the fool could be. But this time, believe me, I'm not fooling. I just can't talk my heart into unloving.
Ralph showed up on some projects for other artists in the 80s. Neil Young's Old Ways album from 1985 is not the favorite album of many fans, but Moon did great work on it. One of Buck Owens' final studio albums was 1988's Hot Dog. He re-recorded Under Your Spell again, which Mooney had played on, so they brought him back to play on it again. In the session, he kept kicking off Foolin' Around instead of the song he was supposed to do. When Buck came over the studio monitor to tell him he was playing the wrong song, Ralph said, "Yeah, but he liked that one better." In 1988, Mooney had a heart attack, quit drinking, and quit smoking. Wynn Stewart had died of a heart attack in 1985 at the age of 51. I don't know if these things informed Mooney's eventual decision to get off the road, but he did retire in the 90s, spending most of the last 15 years of his life quietly at home. Well, maybe not quietly.
Howdy, Moon.
Howdy.
All right. Hey, Moon.
Huh?
Play Crazy Arms for me.
Do I have to?
Just like you wrote it.
Oh, okay. Okay, I'll try it and see how it comes out, okay?
Thank you for listening to Cocaine and Rhinestones. If you still don't subscribe to the podcast anywhere, you definitely should. On whatever app you're using to listen, or you can go to cocaineandrhinestones.com and subscribe by email, so you'll at least get an email when new episodes come out. One more time, I can't end without saying thank you again for listening to this podcast. Thank you so much for listening, for sharing, everything else. I hope I can keep doing this. Thank you.
I'm simply wild about my good cocaine. A lot of babies in the cradle in New Orleans. The doctor kept a whip until the baby got me. Doctor whip until the baby got so. Mama said you couldn't smell no more. Lord, go. Doctor rang the bell. The women in the alley. I'm simply wild about my good cocaine.